afternoon. My name is Amanda Winkey. I'm a non-traditional student at Cheyney University. I'm at the home of Mr. and Mrs. Leroy Carter. We're here for an interview with him pertaining to his arts. He is a prolific artist from Chester County. I'm also here with my professor, Dr. Clarence Harris, and we will interview him, and he will give us an in-depth experience of art and how it has influenced his life and how it can influence others. Mr. Carter, can you elaborate on how you started art and what motivated you in that area?
Yes, I'd be happy to, Amanda. I started in art at 62 years old, and the inspiration came from for me to get started into painting the Underground Railroad came from my great-grandmother, who was a slave. And I did one painting of, my first painting was of one of the local places that had in the Coatesville area that was part of the Underground Railroad. And before I could finish the painting, a newspaper reporter came in and saw it and wanted to know the history of it. I was in art school at the time. And interviewed me and wrote an article on the painting after it was completed. And that launched my career as an Underground Railroad painter.
Right. Mm-hmm. Now, could you tell us something about your family, your life as a young man growing up in Coatesville?
Yes, be happy to. Coatesville was a a very difficult place to grow up in. I grew up in the west end of Coatesville, down behind, across the railroad tracks, down behind the silk mill, sandwiched between Luke and Steel Yard and the silk mill. And Coatesville had a lot of prejudice, I guess, as every other place back in the back in those days. This is back in the late 20s, early 30s, and things were a little difficult for me, I guess, for every black, because you went through the name-calling phase, and you went through places with times when people wanted to make sure that they reminded you who you are, who you were. And I think what really saved the day for me was that early on I was blessed by God by I always tell everyone I was given two talents. I was given my first talent was I could play sports. I played football, baseball, basketball. As soon as I entered sports, my whole life took a different complexion. I no longer became the names that people had referred to me. And back in those days, it was little Black Sambo and that kind of stuff. After that, I became an athlete, established athlete. It was names like Speedy, Pro, and stuff like that. So I noticed, you know, the difference. Mm-hmm. And my last year in high school, I was very, very fortunate because I wound up in the Negro National League with the Philadelphia Stars, baseball. And that was a dream that I dreamed all my life. I wanted to play in the Negro National League. But after I got there, it was like I didn't want to be there. There were things that there were things that were going on that I didn't want to be a part of.
So what were some of those things? Can you elaborate?
Well, I don't want to elaborate on what, I'll say that in the area where I grew up in Coatesville, I saw a lot of men consume a lot of alcohol. Mm-hmm. I didn't want to have any parts of alcohol. And I guess when I got to the point where I was in the Negro National League, I looked around and there it was. And I decided that I have to get out of here. And on top of that, I have a dislike for big cities. Mm-hmm. So I just walked away from it. I took a lot of flack from my family, from my friends, because it was a golden opportunity in which I just blew it. I just walked away. And I came back to Coatesville and went to the steel mill. Mm-hmm. And in the meantime, I got married.
Yes, but before you go on, do you have any regrets as far as, you know, looking back on the league and, you know, maybe you could have stayed and maybe turned a blind eye to different things that were going on and you could have still succeeded that way? Do you have any type of regrets at all about just walking away?
Not a one. I have no regrets because behind the scenes, when you're 19 years old, there are people who are trying to convince you that it's their way to go. Mm-hmm. And they were trying to spike. I was a great one for Coca-Cola and orange soda. Mm-hmm. And I had old-timers who knew that they were there, who were watching over me. Mm-hmm. And they were warning me, don't drink that, you know, don't drink that. That's all they would say, don't drink that. And later on, they were telling me that somebody had spiked the drink. So I got tired of that. Mm-hmm. And I was afraid.
Yes.
And I walked away. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You were more or less fighting for your life because they could have put anything in it.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. But I never thought so much about fighting for my life as I did about someone forcing me into something that I didn't want to be.
Okay. And then you came back and you went into the mill and you got married and...
Yes, I went into the steel mill and I got married. I married my high school sweetheart and we started a family. And 38 years later, looking back in retrospect, that was the smartest thing that I've ever done in my life. I often ask myself, how were you able to be so smart at 19? And the only answer I can come up with is, it wasn't me. There was some guardian angel that steered me. Because I have a beautiful family. Mm-hmm. And I spent 38 years in the steel mill. And I took an early retirement. And up came the other thing that I wanted to be, was an artist. And I decided to go to art school at 62 years old. And it's unbelievable how my life has just gone from one beautiful thing to something else far more beautiful.
So you won, I see a lot of awards and paintings, you know, and different plaques. And so how does all these awards affect you as a human being? The fact that you have paintings in Philadelphia hanging in a gallery, you know, right next to the art galleries, all the art galleries, your art is there. How does that make you feel? Sometimes when you're by yourself, do you think about it? And what type of emotions do you have, you know, as far as the accomplishments that you've made thus far?
Well, it's been an unbelievable string of successes, and I try to keep everything in proportion. I know that what I have achieved in the last 16 years as in the field of art had nothing to do with me. It was a talent, number one, that God gave me, and it was the teachers who spent their time with me to develop that talent, and it was my family who gave me their support. So I try to keep everything in perspective. I don't ever want to become a person where I blow everything out of perspective and my head becomes bigger than I am as a person. So I just take it in stride. Whatever people think of my paintings are fine. Mm-hmm. And I'm not going to get in any debate about how good they are, how bad they are. They can be the judge.
Right. Now, could you show us a few of your paintings and then explain to us, you know, what the paintings stand for? For instance, the one that's hanging over your head, which is a famous painting, the auction and the Negro sales.
Mm-hmm. Well, can you stand up?
Sure, as long as you don't walk away from the cord. Forget you have the cord on.
Okay. This is one of the most...
Just a minute. I see a problem here right now.
Mm-hmm.
The cable is all boiled up. Mm-hmm. There you go. Give you a little more leg room here. Okay, that'll help out a little bit.
All righty. Mm-hmm. Would you rather I take this down or you want to leave it up?
Would be better because I'll tell you why. See, it's going to be, you're going to get a
okay.
perspective shot.
All righty.
As opposed to...
Then it's not going to bother you to get it done? Okay.
No. Where do you want me to hold it?
Okay, that's good.
That's great.
Okay, can you get it perpendicular to the limb?
Sure.
No, perpendicular. Let me see, you're going to have to come out to you're going to have to go counterclockwise a little bit. Counterclockwise. Mm-hmm. Right there, see? See, that means I don't have to deal with perspective too much.
Okay, all right.
Okay, well let's go with that. Okay, let's go with that.
Is that good enough?
Because, sure. Now, are you going to point to something on that?
I can.
Okay, you can rest it on your, whatever way, and then you can point to something if you want.
Okay.
What I can do here now as far as focus is concerned. I better pull in tight on that focus. Here we go. Okay, I'll give you a five count. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2.
This is one of the most awesome of all the paintings that I have done, because it's very hard to believe that humanity can take on the form of cruelty that was administered in the auction houses, but that's what happened here. Here in these types of buildings, black people were treated the same as we treat cattle today. They were physically examined, and their parts were examined without anyone feeling ashamed about what they were doing to them, other than the slave themselves who received it. So. That's what went on here, plus one other important thing. If today we single out the black male, as a lot of people will and have done, and they criticize the black male for walking off and leaving his family. Well, if we want to criticize the black male for abandoning his family, then we have to go back in history to the auction house, the slave auction houses, because here's where it started. In the slave auction house, it's where they sent, they sold whole families, the mother, the children, and the father, not as a unit, but as individuals. And never did they go in the same direction. They went separate directions, never to be reunited again. So this is the place where all of that took place.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we can have that back then.
Right. How's it keep on a roll?
Mm-hmm. Well, you're not going to keep rolling, right?
Oh, yeah, I keep rolling.
Okay. He'll cut it. He'll edit it.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, hang that back.
That's no problem there.
Now, we don't have to basically...
Well, let me see. The other one, you can just point to that one. Because
well, you can see that one? Yeah.
Yes, that
one.
You can see that one.
That one's 40 acres in a mirror.
That's 40 acres in a mirror. I got one upstairs you ought to be in there. The days of the bullwhip.
Oh yeah, you have it. But, yeah. But can your wife get it?
Yeah. Is the machine on?
Oh, yeah, it's on.
You know something? I may have missed that. I better ask you. I know I turned it off, but I'm not sure.
What, the whole thing?
Yeah, I think I'd better get the whole thing over again. Yeah.
Oh, we have to go through.
Huh? Oh, well, I mean, hey.
That's part of it.
I've done some cuts 8 times.
Hmm.
And, okay, here we go, roll again. I'll give you a count again. But I turned, okay, here you go. 5, 4, 3, 2.
This particular painting is titled The Days of the Bullwhip. this young fellow was given, had gone from the plantation that he worked, where he was a slave, to the next plantation to see his girlfriend. And he was given a pass for that period of time. But he made the mistake of staying 1 hour over his time. And when he returned, he was tied to a wagon wheel and given 51 lashes. he could have stopped the lashes far less than 51 lashes by submitting or that he would that or feigning or said he had enough. But he was stubborn, as most youth are, and refused to cry, refused to submit, and he had to take the whole 51 lashes. The unfortunate thing about 51 lashes is, at this particular period in history, the most lashes that any slave had withstood was 41. This young fellow took 10 more lashes, 51, and by the grace of God, he survived. How, they don't know.
Very good. You mentioned something in this narrative that you didn't before. I believe you said that he was strapped to a wheel.
Yes.
Yeah, right. So, mm-hmm. so it worked mm-hmm. out better that way. Okay. Do you want to go to something else now?
That other painting.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll mm-hmm. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2.
From the continent of Africa comes this painting. The subject is a young slave boy. It's called, the title is The Chains and Tears of Slavery. This young man was the son of a tribal leader, which meant that he should never have been picked up and sold as a slave. But somehow or other, once in a while, they did this, and no one had admitted it. But once they found out that they had made this mistake, this young man should have been returned to his people in Africa, to his tribe. His father was a tribal leader, and he was next to inherit that job. But they never did. He came to this country on a ship that docked in New York. And another slave captain there, loading a bunch of slaves onto another slave ship, bought him. And he sailed with this slave captain for 4 or 5 trips. And the slave captain finally sold him, freed him by sold him his rights to be free, and he stayed. He left there and got boarded a ship and went to England. Spent a lot of time in England fighting for the freedom of following slaves. In the movie Amistad, you will see this same young man displayed in one of in a picture of him in the movie. His name was Aquino Orlando.
Now we want to do that one.
Oh, okay, hold a minute. I didn't know. I want to get a tight shot on that.
Yeah, okay.
Well, let me see.
Because I know he's standing up. You can see.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Sitting up a while.
Let me try once more. Okay. I'm zooming in on it. Try once more and then I don't want to do his picture justice.
Okay, now you can just point to that one, the one up here, the 40 acres and a mule.
Almost made him come alive, I see.
Yeah. You want me to hang it back for you?
No, that's okay. Not unless it interferes with the...
That's not any problem.
No problem?
I'm pointing it. I'll get something on this first.
Mm-hmm.
I'll get a little still on and then you can... I'll pull back wide and then you can...
Would you rather I take this one down?
No,
or?
You're okay. You're okay there. Okay.
That's right. You can just stand, you know...
All right,
that's
me?
Not as bad as the other ones.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay, now I'm going to pull wide and I'll give you a count, okay? Let me see. Boy, something's wrong. That must be dirty. Or else in my eyes, you don't want to see. Okay, here we go. 5, 4, 3.
Painting that I'm pointing at is... of the called 40 Acres and a Mule. During the Civil War, there were 186,000 black troops who fought in the Civil War. And there was the white troops received $13 a month. And the black troops received $3 less, $10 a month. A senator from a congressman, rather, from Lancaster, Thaddeus Stevens, tried to get three times to pass a bill to equalize the difference in the pay to make it equal by giving the black troops who fought in the Civil War 40 acres and a mule for their participation in the Civil War. That came up three times and before in 65, and it was defeated. So actually the black troops never received their 40 acres and a mule.
So that's why that picture there was painted.
Yes, yes.
In honor of those.
Honor of those.
Because I've often wondered, too, you hear that. Now it's part of your everyday speech, 40 acres of the mule,
right.
If you're black. If
right.
you're born black, you're bound to hear it one time or another in your
right.
life.
Right,
yeah, so, but what we want now is for you to basically elaborate in depth to try to get to the students, to let the students know at Cheyney. I would like for you to address them and let them know how important it is to go after your dream, to pursue your dream, and most importantly, do it with honesty. Do it justly and do it with compassion.
Mm-hmm.
Cut a second there.
could you, you've already done, I already have that on Cheyney. Could you be a little more generalized rather than say students at Cheyney, young people?
Young people,
right.
Yeah.
Sure.
We can say young people.
No problem.
In other words, we won't have any problem as far as, other young people seeing.
Right, mm-hmm. Yeah, that's
okay.
Right.
Okay, here we go again. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Yeah, you're going to give him the same spiel, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, here we go.
No, it's
not. Whoop. I have to give you another character because I was on there.
Okay.
I don't want that
all
on
right.
That. I don't want to be on it. Okay, here we go. 5, 4, 3, 2.
Now that we're coming to the close of our interview, it's been a delight, as always, to be in your presence. And before we close, I would like for you to give some fruitful advice to young people that will encourage them to be more positive and to be more, have more zeal and compassion in going after their dreams, and to go after these dreams and acquire these dreams with knowledge and with honor.
I think we're most of our students make, young people make their mistake is, particularly African American youngsters, I think for some particular reason, I don't know why, they believe that they're playing on a level field, and that's not the the field wasn't level when I was a youngster. It wasn't level when my father was a youngster before me, or his father. I don't know of any person who, in between, who has, any African American who has played on a level field. So what I'm trying to pass on to the students, and when I get a chance to go into schools, I specifically hope that the African American students are getting what I'm saying above everyone else. My father always taught me, and I pass it on to my children, what you have here, is manifested by how much you want to learn something, how much you want to become something. And once you get it here, it's yours. Nobody can open that up your head and take that out. It's there. It's implanted in you to carry on. When I was a baseball player, at the time the white major leagues were closed to black ball players. The barrier wasn't broken till 1947, I believe, or 48, when Jackie Robinson lowered the barrier. But there were terrific black ball players who played in segregation in the Negro National League. And the only reason they weren't in the major leagues because of the color of the skin. But they still performed. They could have done something else. They still perform. So we as a people, there are things that we have to. I think most of us first have to go back and remember. Find out who we are, where we came from. And then we can decide where it is we want to go. Without our ancestors being courageous and religious enough to take the beatings that they took, working for nothing, and survived and went on to leave a legacy for us, the ones who came after them, that we could step on their backs to get where we are, we have to remember that we walked. I always remember daily particularly when I think of my grandmother, the slave lady.
Oh.
I walked on her back to get where I am. And I won't ever forget that. All of those slaves, we owe them something. And to me, to repay them, we ought to try to be the best that we can be, the most that we can be. We don't have to do things that are stupid to eliminate ourselves and kill each other, because that's exactly what somebody wants us to do. So when we do it, we save them the problem of doing it, because we're doing it for them. Stay in school and get all of the education you can get. My father always told me, if you have it up here, there's not too much they can do to you. And if you have it, there's always a chance you get a chance to use it. If you don't have it, now you got a problem. Right.
But if you don't have it, what's some good advice?
Well, if you don't have it, I would advise seeking out some way that you can learn something, a trade or something. Mm-hmm. Because it's frightening in today's world. If you don't know anything, if you can't make a contribution to society, if you read the papers, if you read magazines, there's not too much left for you. Somebody's going to come along with a giant bulldozer, dig a ditch, and cover you over. Yeah. That sounds crude.
It's true. It's true.
But it's, there ain't nothing left for you.
That's right.
Right. There's nothing left for you.
Yeah. So with that, Mr. Carter, I thank you from the depths of my heart.
Thank you.
And this has been a day that I've waited for years now. And with this moment, me being here with you, being with Professor Dr. Harris, being with your wife, and meeting your son for the first time, this is a day that I will carry with me till the end of my days. And I thank you.
Thank you.
Reach hands and shake hands again. I want to pull them tight on that. Hold it right there. No, don't shake it. Just hold it tight.
Hold it.
There you go. Give me about 10 seconds of that. Okay, cool.
All right.
Thank you.
All right.
you ran through there like man of war.
What?
That interview. Mm-hmm. That's okay. We can come back some other time. But gosh.
You wanted more.
Oh, yeah. Look, I only got
we can give you more.
25 minutes on this.
Oh,
thing.
You want some more?
I mean, I have it. I tell the kids, don't worry about the mule going blind. Just move the wagon, right? That's the old one. Yeah, they say, where did you hear that from? Well, I say, I don't know who I heard it from, but I heard it from somebody older than me. Okay, we go 5, 4, 3, 2.
Sojourner Truth. She was one of the two pillars of the black history. The other strong pillar was Harriet Tubman, but they approached the same subject with different angles. Sojourner was an orator, and she spoke and many, many places all over the United States, and very forceful speaker, and very talented lady. I remember reading in a book where she even met the Abraham Lincoln, and Mr. Lincoln says to her that he'd heard of her, but it was the first time. He hadn't heard of her, and he was happy because it was the first time that she had met him, that he had met her. But she said that she'd never met him before, but she knew exactly who he was. So she was a very outspoken lady and a great lady. She was born into slavery in New York State. And I think she was 90 years old when she died, but a remarkable, remarkable lady.
So what would you say to women of today, you know, as far as following Sojourner Truth's lead or adopting some of the things she did as a black female?
Well, if okay, doctor?
Sure. Well, okay, sure. We're rolling. That's okay.
Rolling. If you go back into black history and you read black history, study black history, the thing that made black history successful was not the black male, but the strong black woman. Without the strong black woman, I don't think there would have been too many survivors of the black race left at the end of slavery. But it was a strong black woman that bore the brunt of the slave movement. Women like Sojourner and Harriet Tubman, they were terrific. And the reason I say that is that you take Most African men, African American men, the slaves, who objected or resisted, they were taken care of. They were beaten to death or lynched or something. But a woman in the slave movement, she could mouth off, and she could. She did a lot of things, notably Harriet Tubman. Harriet Tubman carried a $40,000 price tag on her head that no one ever tried to collect. If Harriet Tubman had been a man, he'd have been out of there a long time before. But there was something magical about the black female. She was strong, she was mouthy, and she got the job done. And for some reason, they dare not touch her. Mm-hmm. So that's a legacy. I think that young black women today, and I'm not criticizing them, but I'm telling them, you know, about the strength of the black woman during the slave movement, and that's what got us where we are. Mm-hmm. Plus the great belief in God. Otherwise, we'd have never made it.
So do you think, you know, what's your view on the new millennium, the 21st century for the black woman?
And in what respect? Are you asking me if I think that
Are they going to, you know, are we going to see more Sojourner Truths and more Harriet Tubmans as history goes on?
I hope so. But I think that we're going to have to go back, and like I said before, we're going to have to go back as a people and find out who we are and what got us to where we are and where it is that we want to go. I've been into schools, sadly, where you address a group of youngsters, and the ones that you get the most disrespect from are my own people. Mm-hmm. And I can't figure that out. They do not want to hear anything about slavery. Perhaps it's embarrassing to them. Shameful, but nevertheless, we are what we are.
That's right. Yeah. So do you think religion is a good step in the right direction as far as, since religion and belief in God is what brought us thus far, do you think, you know, more of us coming together in a religious arena, do you think that would help our people?
Well, I don't know whether I should answer that or not.
Okay.
And I'll tell you why, because someone's going to take out of text what I'm saying.
Okay. Yeah.
You know, I think in the context of what the slaves went through, they knew that religion was their own salvation. That's what made them withstand what they did, and they believed that. But in today's world, most of us don't even know where we came from, and most of us care less. And a lot of this, a lot of churches don't even want to talk about the slavery. So we've lost something. We've lost something. We've lost the institution that should be foremost in getting us together and showing our respects for the people who got us where we are. But we don't seem to want to do that. Yeah, and that's the thing that I think, you know, why I answered you like I did. I think people that hear this will probably think I'm an atheist or something. Mm-hmm. But there's so many other things that are important to the churches today than what it is to hear about our own history and the people who got us where we are.
There was one thing I heard about years ago, and I wasn't privy to the information about the riot they had here in the 30s in Coatesville. There was some type of a riot, police riot they had in Coatesville.
Yeah, that was in 1937. Are you speaking of one where they tried to lynch a man here?
Okay, can you hold it? Can you ask the question?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'll give you a count just a minute. Oh, yeah. There we go. Got your thoughts together?
Yeah. Could you?
Do you want to sit down?
Yeah, sure.
Let me try to hide this.
Oh, no. The camera can see all right. Okay, here we go. 5, 4, 3, 2.
Now, I was a small girl, but I've, you know, heard through the grapevine that there was some type of race riot here in the city of Coatesville some time back. Do you know anything of that, or were you in the area then? Or?
Well, were you talking about in the 30s or before that?
Well, were there more than one? I know of the man that was dragged out of the hospital up here,
yes.
Coastal Hospital, and burned alive.
1912, Jack
right.
Walker.
Right, Jack Walker. I know yeah. about that. Matter of fact, that's mm-hmm. in the mm-hmm. that's in the books. That's written about.
Mm-hmm.
But was there another one?
1936 or 37, they tried a repeat of that. Mm-hmm. But the only thing that. Only thing that prevented it and saved a young man's life was the fact that for once the black people got together, not only in Coatesville, from all over the area, Philadelphia, Reading, every place, and they prevented that. Mm-hmm. I don't want to get involved in naming the young black man because he still lives.
Mm-hmm.
But yes, that happened in 1936 or 37.
Mm-hmm. What was, I mean, was it a lot of casualties or?
No.
Nothing,
there was a report out that this young man had raped a young woman, and which he didn't.
Mm-hmm.
And they took it from there. But there, luckily, the cooler heads prevailed, I guess you can say, and they didn't get to the point where it erupted. I guess if he'd have gotten out of the car at the given spot where they told him, it would have happened, but he didn't do it.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But the girl, the young lady, he never touched her. I think she was in family way by somebody else, but it wasn't a black guy that did it.
Mm-hmm. They later found that out?
Of course they found it out. They knew it before.
Mm-hmm. Now, then, you know, I've heard too, you know, just speculation that Pennsylvania is basically a racist, one of the most racist states, you know, in the country.
Well, I wouldn't want to speculate on that particular. I wouldn't want to venture an answer to mm-hmm. that particular question. But I'll say this: the 1912 incident involving Zach Walker was the only lynching of a black man in any city in Pennsylvania. That has never happened before. It never happened afterwards. And the city of Coatesville, it happened on a Sunday morning. They took the man out of the old Coatesville Hospital over here, and they let church out at 11:45 so that the people could go and participate or watch the lynching. But I do know that there have been a couple books written on that, and it was a sad day for Coatesville. Mm-hmm. They took Coatesville off the map, I believe, something like 12, 13 years or something like that. And no one ever was arrested or served any time for what happened to Mr. Walker.
But why did they deem it necessary to do that to him?
Well, once again, we get back to. There's a book out that maybe you ought to read. It's called No Crooked Death. It's written by two college professors. One of them's from Millersville, and I forget where that other professor from. It's up in that area somewhere. But they both met at the archives in Washington. They were researching the same thing. They didn't know it until they met there. Mm-hmm. And then they collaborated on this book. And Coatesville tried to stop the publishing of that book. They didn't want to publish, but these two men prevailed. In that book, it's Coatesville back in those days was like any other town where people Saturday nights or Friday weekends, people drank a lot. Everybody carried a gun. They fired the guns and that. Zach Walker lived down in Modena in a camp down there near the Worth Brothers Steel Company. He worked for Worth Brothers. And he had too much to drink. He's going home, and he saw this Polish fellow who was a European, and he just started flying in the air. He didn't shoot at him. He started flying in the air. The guard from Worth Brothers attempted to arrest Mr. Walker. Now, a guard at a steel company doesn't have any jurisdiction in the city of Coatesville or the city or the borough of Coatesville. Once he's off the company property, he can't arrest anyone. The only thing he can do, if he got any information, is give it to the city or the borough. But he attempted to arrest Mr. Walker, and during that struggle, it's when the gun went off, and the guard was killed. Then they started the rumor that Walker had raped a white woman, the same rumor that that popped up in 1936 or 37. Mr. Walker did not rape anyone. But the sad thing about that was the churches let out There were several sad things about that. The churches let out so that the people could go participate in the lynching. Mr. Walker was never given a burl. You hear me? Listen to what I'm telling you. He was never, his remains were never buried. There were a lot of his remains were picked up, kept for souvenirs. There were people digging them digging his bones out of the far, keeping them. People had his fingers, the hand burned, they pick off the finger. A lot of stuff went on. And the saddest of which was there were two black churches in Coatesville at the time. Neither one of them came forward to claim his remains. So speculation tells you that either as to what happened to his remains, the wind blew his dust away, the animals carried his bones away, or the birds carried his bones away. His people in Leesburg, Virginia, they didn't even come to claim his remains. They were frightened. So there's never been any closure to that. Mr. Walker was never given a burl.
So maybe this is why we have that gloom.
It's no maybe about it.
Because I wonder,
you took the words. I was waiting for you to talk. Ask me that.
I've been wondering all my life.
That is the background. That is the background of why Coatesville is the way it is today.
That is why. And until they rectify that or make some kind of apology or come forward, we will continue to have
it. Will
this
all be
gloom.
Here. If you read the book, you can get that book today through the libraries.
Right up here in town.
Any library will get that book for you, and you read it and you have to return it to them. But in that book, these college professors made one recommendation. They recommend that Coatesville be ostracized. They recommend that they bring in a giant bulldozer from the east end of the bridge and one from the west end and bury the whole city. And I think they let it set for about 10, 12 years.
Mm-hmm.
And then get a priest to perform exorcism over it and let it set there. At the end of that period, then dig it up and rebury it. I was waiting for you to ask that.
I wonder why.
That's the problem here.
That's right.
But see, nobody wants to admit. They know what the problem is, but they don't want to admit it.
That's the problem.
But it's never gonna. It will never be put to rest.
No, you can't. Not after that.
Will never be put to rest.
Well, time is running out.
I got good footage.
Time is running out, old friend. I'm going to get that book today. I'm going to write the name down before I leave. I have to read that book. But I've often wondered, there is this evilness, this gloom everywhere. Even when the sun is out, even when it's summertime,
it's here.
It's here
all the time.
All the time. Mm. You can't get away from it. Mm. And when you leave, I noticed that, when you leave, it's like this force. You know, it's like you pull away from this force. Mm-hmm. And when you come back, because it's us, you know, we're here, we live here, so the gloom is on us because we have to change this.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to share in the blame.
Of course we have to share in the blame.
So this is why.
Those two black churches were here.
They have to share.
They had to share in the blame because the least they could have done for the man was to
go get his remains.
Get his remains and put the man in. Everybody deserves to be put on the ground. But they failed to do that.
Well, can I have my hug?
Well, if your boyfriend's not around.
I don't have one.
I don't want your boyfriend shooting me, old man.
Oh, God bless you. God bless you.
Thank you. But that's okay. People say that they don't know what's married Coatesville. There's a lot of people know what's married Coatesville.
That's it.
That's right.
And the sins of the father.
That's exactly what my father. Absolutely.
And this is what is happening.
That's right.
You know, because you can be the best parent. I've seen it. You can be the best parent in the world, but it's something that drags these children.
Right.
You know, we're losing many of them.
He talked to the old timers, and we'll get back to my dad again. He says it ain't going to get any better till somebody repents.
That's it. And you said that before in my paper that I wrote. You said, until someone says that they're sorry.
That's right. Somebody's got to walk up and say, I'm sorry.
Yeah. And until then, things will basically remain the same. But again, thank you, thank you, thank you. And you have a Merry Christmas.
Same to you and the professor.
Yeah, they thanks to Professor Harris.
That's right.
Come on in here.
A lot of people know. A lot of people know what's wrong with Coatesville.
Come on, baby. Come on, we all get together.
But see, they try to pretend that it.
I haven't heard someone use that vernacular.
I ain't studying that. Well, come on, let's go.
Yeah, they try to pretend that they didn't know. They don't know what's married Coatesville. I know what's married Coatesville. A lot of black people around here know what's married Coatesville.
Yeah.
So you guys.
Oh, yeah, yeah, just hold it for a little bit. I always like to use different footage.
Okay.
Okay, she can look under the camera.
Don't be ashamed.
Okay.
All right.